All right, I thought I would put together slides again. I normally use the electronic Bible, but maybe give me some feedback. I felt like it does take me a bit more time to put these slides together, but what it allows me to then do is like bold and underline certain lines. So I don't know if that helps you get a bit more out of the sermon, help you follow along a bit better. But give me your feedback, because if you tell me it doesn't make a difference, then I won't do it. And then I can save that time. But if you think it's better, then maybe it's worth it, and then I can decide whether it's worth putting in that extra time. So today I want to preach about the topic of teaching your children. And we want to start here in Deuteronomy 6, and the title of my sermon is Teach Them Diligently Unto Thy Children. And here we start. We start here in Deuteronomy 6. Verses 6 to 7. The Bible reads here, "And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up." So we see here that the command from Moses to the children of Israel, which we can apply today just from the word of God, is that we are responsible and we are commanded to teach diligently the word of God to our, to our children. And I've got underlined here, shall be in thine heart. Why? Because it starts with you, doesn't it? If you want to teach your children the word of God, then you first need to be a student of the word of God. You need to study the word of God, meditate on the word of God, memorize the word of God, think about the word of God, figure it out, discuss it with other people, because then only then you can discuss it with your children. And for those of you who have taught people, in order to teach somebody something, you need to know that topic really well. Right? My dad used to always tell me, that if you can't explain something to somebody else, it's because you don't know it well enough, right? My dad would always say to me, hey, if you know, because the reason why you're finding it hard to explain, because I used to try to explain something to my dad and be like, it's just too hard to explain. And he'd just say, that's because you don't know it well enough. Because if you knew it well enough, it would be easy to explain. And think about the things that we do know really well. We can explain those things without notes. If people ask us about it, we just start talking about it because we know that topic really well. And that's why the Bible says here, we're going to teach our children diligently. It's not just, hey, the commandment is not to teach your children. The command is also, hey, they need to be in your heart, right? That means you need to be meditating on them, dwelling on them, thinking about them, figuring them out. And if they're in your heart, you're going to be able to teach your children diligently. Now, here it says here in verse 7, and thou shalt teach. Now, thou is singular. That's one reason why the King James Bible is more accurate than a lot of other Bibles, because it retains this these, thous, and thines, which are a singular you as opposed to a plural you. When the Bible says thee or thou, it's referring to a single person. But when the Bible says you, it's referring to a group of people. That's why when Jesus says to Nicodemus, marvel not that I said unto thee, Nicodemus, ye must be born again. He's not just saying you, Nicodemus, must be born again. He's saying you, everyone, must be born again, right? And we see that difference there where that is lost in other Bible translations. It says, thou shalt teach them diligently. So we see here the singularity of it being, hey, it's your responsibility as parents to teach your children. It's not the school's responsibility, if you send your child to a school. It's not the church's responsibility to teach your children. Yes, they can support you in teaching your children diligently, but ultimately the responsibility lies on you. If your children do not learn the word of God, you can't blame the church. You can't blame the Sunday school. If your church has a Sunday school, you can't blame the school teacher. It comes down to you teaching your children and taking that responsibility. Look at what it says here in Ephesians 6:4. And ye fathers especially, are responsible for training up their family. Why? Because they're the leader of the house. They're the leader of the home. It's not a leadership quality to say somebody else is going to do it. Somebody else is going to make sure it gets done. It's a leadership quality because you make sure it gets done and you hold people accountable, or you support your wife in teaching your children. So Ephesians 6:4 says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So you see here, it's not a command to the church, is it? Yes, the church has a responsibility to teach all nations and baptize them and to teach the commandments of the Lord. But when it comes to teaching children in specifically, it's a command to fathers. It's not a command to an organization or to a group of people. So the church will support you in teaching your children, and that's why we're going to talk about that in a second, why we do things the way we do. But it's not the primary teacher for your children. It's more like a supplement. You know, you can't survive a diet on just supplements, right? Like if you just drank supplements and didn't eat any food, you know, you eat your daily food, you're not going to live. You're not going to be healthy. It's the same in your spiritual life. If all you have in your spiritual life is what you hear on Sunday nights from this pulpit, or or whatever, right? That's not going to be enough. You're not going to survive spiritually. You need your daily intake of spiritual food. Deuteronomy 4:9 says here, only take heed to thyself. So this is a similar command previously in two chapters before. Only take heed to thyself. So again, before it talks about teaching diligently, again, it's saying, hey, you need to make sure you yourself are learning the word of God. Keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget the things from which thine eyes have seen, and lest they depart from thy heart all the days of thy life. But teach them thy sons. But look at this, not just your children, and thy sons' sons. So the Bible here is even exhorting us, hey, it's not enough just to be involved in the education of our children, but to be involved in the education of our grandchildren. Take part, support. You know, one thing we need to take on board is, hey, we need to support our children when they teach their children, right? So be part of teaching the third generation, not just your children. And that's very important. Let's go back to Deuteronomy 6:6-7. These words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Now, when you read verse 7, do you get this idea that teaching our children is just like this set time every week or every month? No, it isn't, is it? What is the Bible commanding us to do here? God is commanding us here to teach them constantly at every opportunity. So whilst family devotions are good, you know, a lot of Christians have family devotions where it might be like a certain time of the week where you sit down, you read a Bible passage, and you do similar to what you do in church at home. I'm not against family devotions. I think family devotions can be very helpful. But the point I want to make is that they're not sufficient, right? If you have this frame of mind, you know, I go to church once a week, and that's one time we talk about God, and then we have a family devotion, and that's the other time we talk about God. That's not enough. That's not what's commanded of you. What's commanded of you is that you teach them diligently. You talk of them when you're sitting in your house. This is like any time of the day, right? Whether you're sitting in your house or whether you're walking by the way, like when you're just walking with your children, sometimes they'll ask you a question, right? That's an opportunity to teach them the things of God. When you lie down, so it's like before you go to bed, sometimes children will ask questions. That's when they're most restless, right? Because they don't want to go to sleep. So that's when they might be asking questions just to stay awake and to not go to bed. I know my kids are like that. You know, like Simon, you get him to do something and then he'll ask you a question because it sort of delays what he needs to do. When thou liest down and when thou risest up. So it's not just, you know, when you're resting, it's not just when you're stationary, it's when you're on the move. It's not just when you go to bed at night. It's also when you get up in the morning. So it's all times of the day, all different activities. That's the point that verse is trying to make. So teach your children when the moment happens. You know, because you don't want to wait till the family devotion when you teach your children. When the moment happens, that's the time to teach your children, right? And this is one of the advantages of homeschooling versus public schooling. Because, you know, can you trust the school teacher at school to take that opportunity infuse? I'm trying to think, like, you know, the opportunity to infuse some biblical truth when the child is most curious because they've just come across an event and they're asking a question. You know, one of the advantages of homeschooling is that a God-fearing parent is now there to fulfill that curiosity and give them the right answer, as opposed to they've thought about it, they've been given the wrong answer, and now they're not thinking about it anymore, and then you ask them at home, well, what did you learn at school? And, you know, do they even remember everything that happened during the day? So that is definitely one of the advantages of homeschooling versus public schooling, is the fact that you spend time with your children as opposed to somebody else spending time with your children. And that's definitely one thing I talk about when I talk with colleagues and things, and they hear that I'm planning on homeschooling my children, and they ask why. I always have, like, you know, two key points, or, you know, a key point that I'll share with them to say why. And I know that this is a huge advantage over public schooling. And one of them is, well, you know, you have children, you want to spend time with them. You know, I sometimes explain, you know, teachers, people who teach children, they know how much of a relationship they have with those children. Why? Because they're spending day in and day out with them. They're asking them questions. They're teaching them things. And often, sadly, school teachers have a better relationship with the child than the parent does, right? And I explain to them, you know, my wife wants to have that relationship with her child and not give that to somebody else. So public schooling cannot replace that relationship with your child, that time that you have given to somebody else. So that's one of the advantages. Obviously, there are pros and cons, and everyone has to make that decision. I personally think the pros of homeschooling outweigh the cons, because the other reason I tell them is just to be able to control the influence that people have on your children. Because no unbeliever just lets their children just hang with anybody, right? It's just to what extent people take that control and decide who they're going to hang with, who they don't. So with a public school, with a school, you have absolutely no control, right? Because just whatever parent sends that kid to school. And parents and teachers aren't there all the time. Like, the kids are hanging out unsupervised. So it's not a risk that I want to take with my children, especially when they're in their young years and they're very impressionable, to send them off to a school not knowing the parents of the kids that are going to be going to that school with them. As well as, you know, why would I take away that blessing from Elizabeth? Yes, it's more work. And that's the downside of homeschooling, right? It is more work to train and to teach your children. And you do need patience, obviously, to go through their work with them. But what do you gain from it? You know, you gain the time and the influence, and to be able to mold that young soul to love God and to have a biblical perspective of the world. So the more time you have with them, the more you will influence your children. Last thing I want to just point out in this verse, it says, he teach them diligently. And this is really the point I want to drive home today, is just teaching our children diligently. And we talked about diligence when we talked about serving God. So what do you think of when you think of teaching somebody diligently? You're going to be proactive, right? You're not going to be reactive to the things they're going to learn. You're going to make sure, hey, I want you to learn these things and hear about these things, as opposed to just letting them float through life until they wonder about it. You want to be purposeful, right? There's a reason why you're teaching them these things. Be consistent in how you're teaching them. Be thorough. You want to be open and be honest. And I think this is really important if you want to build a relationship with your children, that you are open and honest with them and do not hide things from them. And this is the reason why you ought not lie to your children about, you know, Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny and things like that, because lies do not build relationships. You know, if you're lying to your children all the time, how do you expect them to trust you when you tell them about the things of God? So this is what relationship building is all about. And even in your marriages, even in your friendships, if you want to have a good relationship, it needs to be open and honest. If there are things that you can't talk about in your relationship is not where it could be. See, when I think about my relationship with my wife, there's nothing that we don't talk about. Like, and I can talk about anything with my wife without my wife thinking that I'm stupid, or, you know, are you crazy for thinking this? Or, because we have this sort of relationship where, hey, we can bring up anything with each other. We can laugh with each other. We can talk about things openly. There are no no-go zones. You know, my wife can talk to me about anything and everything, even if there's negative things about me. You know, and we have that sort of relationship. And that's why I believe we are able to be so close, because we have that sort of open communication. And you guys know that when you, even with a mate, right? If you have a friend that you have a bit of a wrestle with and now there are no-go zones, that fellowship is hindered, isn't it? It's no different in a marriage. It's just, it comes out even more in a marriage, more in a relationship, because you spend even more time together. So even more so, you need to make sure that you're open and honest with one another, and you make sure there are no-go zones. And if you know that there's a no-go zone in your life, you know, these are the things you should talk about, because you should bring it up then, because your spouse may be worried about bringing it up because they know it's a no-go zone. But if you know it's not and you've decided to purposefully change and say, hey, you know what? I want to make sure I've got an open and honest relationship with my friend or my parents or with my spouse or whatever, I'm going to let them know that this is okay to talk about, and you'll make progress. So if you have a good relationship, then you can have an open communication. So it's no different with children, right? That means you can deal with issues and they're less likely to be hidden from you, right? Think about the stereotypical situation of a child just coming to their parent and just springing something on them that they had no idea about. Well, it's because they didn't have that relationship with their child. They didn't know their child. Otherwise, you would have seen it coming. You would have known about it because you would have been talking about things with them. What else do I think of when I think of diligently? You're like explaining things in light of the truth of the Word of God at every opportunity, taking that opportunity, right? Being diligent about it and being proactive about it. Now, one thing I want to just drive home tonight, and one of the main points I want to make is this point about age appropriateness. Because, you know, there's this, it's like, I don't know if it's a cultural thing or it's just an idea that is in many different cultures and many different circles, this idea of age appropriateness. And what do I mean by that? We see that in film ratings, right? Because in film ratings, you've got G for guardian, PG, parental guardian, M, MA, and then you got MA plus. I remember when I was in high school, and you know, because you know MA is like 15 plus, right? And you have to be over 15 years old to get into those. That's the first time you tried to use a fake ID, right? To get into the cinemas to watch that M movie because you were 14 years old. So you got G, P. But this idea of this age appropriateness and this arbitrary age appropriateness, because you know they'll say R rated, right, is 18 plus, as though after you're 18, it's okay to watch pornography. It's never okay to watch pornography. So what does being older make it okay? You know, X-rated or whatever. It's never okay to watch pornography. Doesn't matter how old you are. You can be 80 years old. It's still wrong for you to watch pornography. So where do people get this idea that when you tick over to 18, now it's okay for you to watch all this filth and hire out all this filth or watch it on the internet? So this idea of age appropriateness is this idea that in our culture today that there are things that are suitable for adults but not suitable for children. You know, it's the reason why we have this, you know, stereotypical, I guess, situation that's, you know, often in films, right, where a child will come to the parent and ask about, you know, the birds and the bees. And the parents are like awkward and go, oh, like how did they hear about it? Because it's not something they're meant to know about, right? It's not something that, you know, who told them about it? Why are they curious about this? They're a child. They shouldn't know about these things. It's this idea in our culture about age appropriateness. That's why they happen, because they've discovered something that supposedly that they're too young to know about. It's the reason why Sunday schools and children's Bible classes are so watered down that children of Christians these days grow up with a warped view of God and the Bible. What do I mean by that? They learn these Bible stories, but they don't learn the full story, right? Because of this idea in our culture of age appropriateness that, yeah, we can tell them about David and Goliath, but let's not tell them the whole story, right? Because it's not appropriate for children. So parents avoid teaching it from this idea. And preachers avoid preaching it, right? That's why there are certain things that won't be preached about from the Bible in church, because it's not age appropriate, right? Because it's not appropriate for children. So then they sort of like censor their message a bit, or they won't go to certain passages in the Bible because they feel that it's not appropriate. And one of the major topics is just, you know, talking about sex. You know, sex is not a taboo word. I don't know why people think sex is a curse word. You know, a curse in the sense that, you know, we would think of four-letter words. Why are those even curse words anyway? I can't remember who in this church I was talking. I was talking about that with. You know, I was saying like, why is the F word a bad word? Why is the S word a bad word? Is it the word itself that is bad? Because you know the four-letter F word, and I mean I'm just saying that because even me, like, it's culturally, it's like it sounds bad to say. You know, we would say things like procreate. We would say sex, but we won't say the four-letter F word, right? Because it's just culturally people have just, you know, and you can watch all these videos on YouTube on why we think certain words are bad, and they come down to, you know, different classes of people, and the Latin words are like, sound really smart and educated, and that's why procreation sounds really good, but then, you know, F-U-C-K does not sound good, because that's like, I don't know, it comes from German or something like that. I don't, can't remember. You can watch all these videos on why we feel the way we do about certain words, and then it's just promulgated through culture, right? Because we teach our children, don't say that word. So then it just stays a bad word. And it's like this with different themes in the Bible. We've told our children for so long, don't show your children bloodshed. Don't show your children, you know, don't talk to your children about sex. Don't talk to your children about all these things, that we get this idea of age appropriateness when it's nowhere to be found in the Bible. Because, you know, children are naturally curious, right? For those of you who have been around children, even my children, I mean, from a very young age, they start asking questions. Like, there's no way I could have avoided, even if I tried, avoiding the topic of male and female, marriage, children, the bedroom, you know, sex and whatnot, because they're asking about it. Because, I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to start wondering, where do people come from? You know, and like, why do people get married and all these things? So if you have this idea, or you're just not going to talk about it, you're going to lie to them about it and say, oh, the crane brings the babies along and all this sort of thing. Or you, if you avoid it, you're only going to reinforce in their minds that you are not a source of trustworthy information. And they're going to find that information somewhere else, whether it's mates, whether it's a bad influence. They will ask somebody else. But you know what? If they're curious about something, and then you tell them the answer, you tell them the right answer, and you are mature about it, you know, you might have to explain things simpler, that'll satisfy their curiosity, and then they don't think about it anymore. You know what I mean? Like, they might come up with a question later, but it's not like they're just bugging you about it because you didn't give them the answer. If you give them the answer and it makes sense, they're like, okay, well, now they know the answer. It's nothing, it's not a big deal. And that's what I've found with my kids. When they wonder about something and I just tell them the truth about it, you know, I don't censor it. I'm not inappropriate about it either. So I say it just how I would explain it to any other adult. You know, I might have to explain some other words and make it a bit simpler for them so that they understand, but I'm not shading them from anything. I explain to them, you know, why boys have a penis and girls have a vagina and what they do and all those sorts of things. It shouldn't be taboo. It should just be part of us teaching children why a boy is a boy and why a girl isn't a girl. And the world has, I don't know whether the world has taught us not to do this, and why, and this is why people grow up with this whole gender, different gender ideology, and, you know, if you have a vagina, you're not a girl, you can actually be a boy, you put on boys' clothes, and all these different things. So they're teaching them that. I mean, they're teaching preschoolers and kindergartners and people in primary school that they can be whatever gender they want, but you think it's wrong to teach them what it means to be a boy and what it means to be a girl because it's not age-appropriate? You know, where does this come from? It doesn't come from the Bible. And this is the point I really want to drive home today in this sermon, is that this concept is not found in the Bible anywhere. And in fact, what the Bible teaches is the total opposite, in the fact that you should be proactive, like we read in Deuteronomy 6, proactive about teaching your children the Bible, proactive about teaching them all the words in the Bible. And if you actually do that, that means you cannot avoid these topics. You can't avoid teaching them these things, because if you're going to explain the different stories in the Bible that we hear about, you know, what are you going to do? You're going to censor it from them, like a Sunday school lesson, like the Sunday school does, where they just change the story. And a story like Noah's Ark goes from being a story of God's judgment and wrath on sin, where he wiped out everyone in the world. Think about this. Every Noah's Ark cartoon you've seen, it's all rosy and happy. Oh, you know, Noah's building this ark and he's collecting up the animals and going in, and they're all happily sailing, and then they come off and then they build. I mean, that's what you're going to find when you look at children's cartoons. But that's not what you read when you read the Bible. You read a God that is angry and he's wrathful, and he's taking vengeance on the earth, and he kills everybody in the earth. Think about this, except 8 people. He only spared 8 people, and he killed everybody else. That's what God thinks of sin. And that's the lesson we ought to take from Noah's Ark. Not that, oh, you know, the world's a beautiful place and he built this pretty boat and God was with Noah and everything. And he was, but if you only tell them half the story, then you're not learning the whole story, which is it's a picture of God's wrath and a picture of what is going to happen, you know, when in terms of hell. So the point, one of the points I want to drive home today is this concept is not found anywhere in the Bible. This idea of age appropriateness, I don't think exists. If it's right for children, it's right for adults. If it's wrong for children, it's wrong for adults, right? If it's wrong for adults, it's wrong for children. See, for children, you might need to explain things in simpler ways for them to understand, but no topic should be avoided. And I believe it should be proactively exposed to them. That way you can control their first impression of it. Because if you bring it up to them, then you can explain it to them, right? As opposed to them finding out and their first impression is a different impression. And then you have to be proactive about correcting that and explaining things to them. So this is why, you know, when we have the preaching in church, everyone is gathered together here, old and young, right? Because the Bible is appropriate for all ages. We don't need to separate off the children. You know, like sometimes you'll have things like that in church where they'll separate off the children because they're going to talk about adult topics, right? But then where do they get this idea that if it's Bible and we're meant to be teaching our children all the Bible, then children should be learning about that too. And if you're talking about things that are inappropriate for children, then you got to think, well, are they appropriate for adults then? Should adults be talking about these things if children can't listen to them as well? So there's a, you know, there's a bit of both in the sense that, you know, some people think that there are things inappropriate for children. And then there's the other things where they're inappropriate for adults. And obviously they would also be inappropriate for children if they're inappropriate for adults. So this is why we have everyone together when we learn the Bible and we talk about the Bible, because all the Bible is appropriate. Look at these two verses I've got up here. 1 Timothy 6:3, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ and to the doctrine which is according to godliness. So the words of God are wholesome. Right? They're good for you, every word of God. Proverbs 30:50, every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. So you see, words are not bad in and of themselves. You know, we talked about curse words, and, you know, I'm not going to say them just because I think just culturally, I don't want to make a point. But, you know, like we think about these swear words, right, that we think about in our culture. Words are not wrong in and of themselves, but it's how they're used, right? If you think about swear words, it's how they're used and the context that people use them. There are other reasons why they are not wise to use as opposed to just being sinful, the word in and of itself. A word is neutral, right? So it says here that every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in them. So if every word of God is good, there is nothing in the Bible that ought to be shielded from our children. Now, there's nothing wrong with games for children. I'm not against Sunday school in the sense that, you know, it's wrong for people to have programs for kids and make it fun and have a spiritual lesson. But it is no substitute for Bible preaching. And that's what happens in a lot of churches where the children are separated off during the preaching. And then they grow up year after year after year up until they're, I don't know how long they keep them in Sunday school these days, but it's like until they're 12 or something like that. And then they come to adults church, right? And then they're so bored because they've never, you know, experienced adult church for like the first, you know, 12 years of their life. And they're shocked when they start to learn things in the Bible because they've had such a warped view from all the watered down Sunday school lessons. So let's look at some examples, right? Let's look at some examples of Jesus from Mark 9, where Jesus, when he preached, he had children present. He didn't split the children off and have the children in a separate room when he taught things in the Bible. Mark 9, he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, "What was it that you disputed among yourselves by the way?" But they held their peace, for by the way, they had disputed among themselves who should be the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12 and saith unto them, "If any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all." And he took a child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his arms, he said unto them, and we'll just stop there for a moment. So think about this. Jesus is preaching, he's talking to a crowd, and he takes a child and sets him in the midst of them. Now, if he takes a child and sets him in the midst, that means children were obviously present, right? Because if children were separated off later, or separated off somewhere, how could he take a child and set him in the midst? And it says here, and when he had taken him in his arms, he said unto them. So this is a child that is small enough to be carried. Now, Simon, come up here for a second. Come here. You're not in trouble. Even though I can see you playing back there, maybe you have to sit here. I mean, Simon is 5.5 years old. Come up here, Simon. But Simon's 5.5 years old, right? And I would think Simon's of the age where you wouldn't really, like, you know, hold him on you. He's pretty big, right? If I was to hold him. Like, because Simon's old enough that he's not really the type you'd hold on your hip, right? So if you think, if Jesus, go sit down there. So if Jesus is taking a child up into his arms, I mean, this child must be pretty small, right? Because, I mean, it's not like I'm going to pick Isabel up, right, and hold her in my arms. Or, like, say, Nicholas. They'd be embarrassed because, you know, they don't want to be treated like a little baby that's, like, you know, cradling on their parents or on Jesus' side. So when he's taking this child up, obviously this child is very young. You know, you'd think probably somebody at Sarah's age or Abel's age, like a child is there where they're small enough that they're used to being carried, and he's in the midst of them. So he's there while Jesus is preaching. Whosoever shall receive one of such children in my name. So if he's saying such children, he's making them an example. Obviously they're there, right? So that he can use them as an example. In my name receiveth me, and whosoever shall receive me receiveth not me, but him that sent me. And John answered him, saying, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and he followeth not us, and we forbade him, because he followeth not us. But Jesus said, Forbid him not. I'll just skip over this for a second, just for sake of time. He says here, And whosoever shall offend one of these little ones that believe in me, it is better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck, and he were cast into the sea. So again, the point I'm trying to make here with verse 42, that as he goes now into this dissertation about hell, I want you to notice that the children are there present, right? So do we get the idea that Jesus holds back when children are in the room, when he's preaching about the horrors of hell? So he goes on, And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having two feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. I mean, Jesus is being pretty graphic, right? You would think, oh, is this appropriate for children, this sort of preaching, Jesus? Well, he did it when children were there, saying, hey, if you need to rip your eye out of its socket so that you would go to heaven, hey, that's something that children need to hear, because they need to realize that if you don't believe on Jesus Christ, you're going to die and spend an eternity in hell. And he's making this point here, where their worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. For everyone shall be salted with fire. Every sacrifice shall be salted with salt. So obviously children were there. They needed to be young enough because he was carrying them in his arms. And then what does he preach on when children are there? He preaches on the horrors of hell and to make sure that we are saved from hell. Why? Because children need to know about hell too. You know, do we raise children just with this idea that God is all roses and teddy bears, but he's not a God of wrath as well? He's not a God that punishes sin, and that he's a God not just to be glorified and honored, but a God to be feared as well, right? So we need to give our kids the whole picture. Whereas how many kids in many Christian churches learn about hell, learn about the horrors of hell? You know, and then they learn about hell and they're like, why would a loving God create hell? Right? Whereas if they learn from their parents that he's a loving God, that's why hell exists, then they would have a different perspective from God as they grow up. And if we train up a child in the way he should go when he's old, he won't depart from it. Look at Mark 10. So this is the next chapter, right? So Jesus is just in Mark 9 said, you know, receive one of these little ones, and he's holding up a child. We can see Jesus loves children. He wants children to be here. But it doesn't look like the disciples get the point, right? Because in Mark 10, just the next chapter over, it says they brought young children to him that he should touch them, and his disciple rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased. So what was Jesus displeased about? That people wanted to bring their children to Jesus, and people were saying, no, you can't have them here. You know that, what that reminds me of? That reminds me of, there are churches out there, and you might not have been to them, but there are churches out there that if you want to have your children in the meeting here, they will not let you have your children in the meeting. And they will make you go to the cry room or wherever that next building is, or the Sunday school. And if you insist on having your children in the congregation, they will say you're not welcome there. There are churches out there like this. But isn't this interesting that Mark 10 is here where people try to bring their children to Jesus? And obviously we can't bring children to the physical Jesus. Now, what's the closest thing? That you bring into the body of Jesus, right? That they're under the word of Jesus, hearing the preaching of Jesus, part of this body here. And he says here, when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased. And, you know, I'm sure that when Jesus sees those churches forbidding the children to come into the church, I'm sure he's much displeased with that as well. He's not happy that children can't be there under the preaching, where we see his example in Mark 9, children are there under the preaching. Right? They're there. And he wants them there, to the point where he even took one up in his arms and continued to preaching, holding one of the children. You know, that's what Jesus is like. He loves the children. And said unto them, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. So, you know, obviously in a church, children are not adults, right? So they make noise, but we need to suffer it. You know, we need to allow them to be there. Yeah, they will make noise. They'll cry. They might do things like that. They might cause distraction. But if it's distracting for you, maybe, you know, in our church, you can move, right? There's plenty of seats you can move to, so it'll be less distracting. You know, especially, you know, if you, let's say you come late, right? Like, say all the parents are sitting at that. Like, in some churches, there's like a mother-baby area at the back. And then some people will complain about children, but they've come late and they're too ashamed to come all the way to the front. And they sit at the back and then they're complaining about why children are so distracting. Well, you know, you weren't meant to sit back there. That was meant to be for, you know, the parents and with children so they could easily come in and out if the child does become a bit too noisome and they need to deal with that. So that's one reason why here, and it's not so bad today, but, you know, like, let's say we had more people and it was a bit more noisy. That's one reason why amplification is good, because we can have a higher noise floor, if that makes sense. You can have more activity going on, people moving in and out, people having to calm their children, tell them to sit still and stuff like that, but you can still hear the preaching. So it's good for churches to have that equipment so that you can have a higher noise floor. I remember in Mexico... if you remember, I can't remember what that guy's name was, Elizabeth, but the church we went to in Mexico that we were last at, they had the noise up like so loud, like the preaching was so loud, and everybody was like so loud. There's always like people talking, like that's not good. I'm not saying that's good, but there were a lot of kids at that church, and because they didn't have air conditioning, they had fans going and everything, so... But it was good for us as parents because you didn't feel like you were making a lot of noise in that church because everything was so noisy. Whereas here it's really quiet. So everyone's tiptoeing around because this room's a bit too quiet. But there everything was like really loud. And the preaching was like super loud because the speakers were up so loud. So that's one good thing about amplification. Now, obviously, they're being naughty and they're throwing a tantrum or something. Then that's obviously the wrong of the parent. You know, number one, you know, we need to do our best to train them at home. But number two, like, if they do play up here, you know, you got to deal with it there and then. You know, either you take them out or you go and discipline them. And that's why I put the spanking stick in the bathroom back there. And there's a spanking stick in the storeroom, you know, in the room next door. Because if you do need to spank your kids, the equipment is there for you to deal with it then and then. And that way you don't have to do this whole, deal with it when we get home. You can deal with it now, and you don't have to deal with it when you get home. And they may not even remember what they did. So let's continue. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and bless them. So again, these children were small enough for him to carry, you know, and they probably wanted to be carried because, you know, children that are Simon's age and up, they don't really, you know, want to be picked up. You know, even when I picked Simon up just then, you notice he's like, because he's a bit probably ashamed of like being picked up. All right, so teaching your children the Bible. I just want to give a couple of examples because remember I said, you know, if you're truly seeking to obey the commands of God and his word, you're going to teach them the whole Bible. There are going to be topics you can't avoid, right? Because they're going to come up. And if you think about the stories that we've learned about in the church here and stories that you are familiar with the Bible, you probably know, and I've mentioned some of them already, and I'm going to use these as an example, that the world would deem inappropriate. Why? Because the Bible contains what the world would deem as adult-themed stories. Let's look at a few examples. But what I'm trying to say is, if God expects us to teach these things to our children, maybe this idea of age appropriateness is not something from the Bible. It's something we're getting from the world. And maybe Satan is using this to stop us and hinder us from actually fulfilling this command and teaching our children all the Word of God and being able to have a discussion about the topics that the Word of God covers. Now, this is probably the stereotypical situation, right? It's about marriage and children. You know, like most people say, oh, you know, when what age do you have that conversation with your children about the birds and the bees, about sex and about marriage, about children, about these things? What age do you talk to them about? Well, the age that they ask. That's what I do. Like, you know, I don't necessarily like have to tell my kids, because when they're an age where they're not wondering about it, they probably don't understand either. Like Sarah doesn't wonder about where children come from. She's just like enjoying her dresses, enjoying her toy. Yeah, she's in her own world. You know, but Simon, he eventually got to the age where he asked where the children come from. Yeah, and all that. And then I just explain it to him. He doesn't understand, I explain it again. And if he doesn't understand, I'll explain it in a way he does understand. And then, you know, when he starts asking different things, then you'll go into more depth as his understanding grows. And look at this. You don't have to get very far in your Bible reading until you come across marriage, right? Marriage is Genesis 2, but Genesis 4 is where Adam sleeps with his wife and they have a child. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived. So this is where children come from. You can talk about conception. And bare Cain, childbirth, and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. And she, again, bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And this is not the only example in the Bible where it goes on this topic of the bedroom and about a relationship between a man and his wife. So if we are talking about the Bible, think about this idea of age appropriateness. If there were things that you shouldn't mention in front of little children, I mean, if we're having children, there's going to be the situation where you have old children and younger children. And if you're going to be talking about them as you walk by the way, when you sit down, when you rise up, when you lie down, I mean, eventually the younger children are going to overhear and they're going to ask as well, right? So this idea that you keep it from them is not something from the Bible. So at the very beginning, even in Genesis, we got concepts of sex, conception, birth, life, death, nakedness, you know, clothing, suffering, family structure as well. Let's go to another example. I wanted to show you here in Joshua 8. We read here verses 30-35. Where not even Moses, when Moses talked about teaching your children all the Word of God, but even Joshua, we see an example of him actually doing this before he goes. I can't remember whether it's before or after now, but in here, when he's talking to the children of Israel, it says here, then Joshua built an altar unto the Lord God of Israel on Mount Ebal, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded the children of Israel, as it is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of whole stones over which no man hath lift up any iron, and they offered thereon burnt offerings unto the Lord and sacrificed peace offerings. And he wrote there upon the stones a copy of the law of Moses, which he wrote in the presence of the children of Israel. Now, sometimes I wonder when I read that, I mean, were people coming and going, or were they just there the whole time as Joshua just sat and wrote out the first five books of the Bible? Because that would have taken a long time. So, you know, were people coming and going and just in the presence of Israel? Is just they were just there generally, or were they all just there watching? Because that would have taken a long time. And all Israel and their elders and officers and their judges stood on this side of the ark and on that side before the priests, the Levites, which bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, as well as the stranger, as he that was born among them, half of them over against Mount Gerizim and half of them over against Mount Ebal, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded before that they should bless the people of Israel. Now look at this, verse 34. And afterward, he read all the words of the law, the blessings and cursings, according to all that is written in the book of the law. There was not a word of all that Moses commanded, which Joshua read not before all the congregation of Israel. Look at this. With the women and the little ones and the strangers that were conversant among them. So we see here that Joshua wrote out all the law, and then the Bible makes it a point that he read everything to everybody with all the women, with all the children present. So does Joshua buy into this idea of age appropriateness? appropriateness, that there are some things that you don't talk about with your children. There are some things that you don't bring up with your children. Now, when we think about what is in the first five books of the Bible, there are things in there that people of this world would easily deem, hey, they're not appropriate for children. Think about Leviticus 20. Leviticus 20, if he's teaching all these laws, we see in Leviticus 20, and you shall keep my statutes and do them. I am the Lord which sanctify you. For everyone that curseth his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. He hath cursed his father or his mother, his blood shall be upon them. Now this one you might not, you know, shy away from. You might want to make sure your children know this one, right? Might keep them in line. But so let's go on. So we got capital punishment, right? How to treat. And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. And the man that lieth with his father's wife hath uncovered his father's nakedness, both of them shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. And if a man lie with his daughter-in-law, both of them shall surely be put to death. They have wrought confusion, their blood shall be upon them. If a man also lie with mankind, as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. And if a man take a wife and a mother, it is wickedness. They shall be burnt with fire, both he and they, that there be no wickedness among you. And if a man lie with a beast, with an animal, he shall surely be put to death, and he shall slay the beast. And if a woman approach unto any beast and lie down thereto, thou shalt kill the woman and the beast, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. Now, Joshua would have read these things, right? Because it's part of the law of Moses. He would have covered these things. These are the things we are expected to teach to our children. So if you buy into this idea of age appropriate, they're not appropriate for children. How are you teaching them these things? You know, these are appropriate for children because it's the word of God, and they need to learn how God feels about adultery, about cursing your mother and father, about lying with an animal, about committing adultery, about man lying with mankind as he lieth with a womankind, homosexuality. So we see these things in Leviticus 20, and yet we think that they're not appropriate for children. We need to teach them because we need to give them the right perspective on these things and tell them that it's wrong, it's sinful, it's disgusting, so they don't grow up thinking that it's normal and that they're born that way, you know, as the media is trying to cram down our throats. What about animals, right? This is another thing that I think is very important that we teach our children, that animals are for food. Genesis 9:3, every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you, even as the green herb have I given you all things. Now, I'm sure that there are parents out there that don't like to tell their children where food comes from, where the meat that they eat comes from. And then what happens? That child grows up and they're just like, oh, I can't believe they're killing all these turkeys. And then you got all these people like, you know, putting mock like funerals for all these turkeys during the Thanksgiving season that you see on YouTube. And, you know, these are the people that have learned that, you know, animals are just for companionship and just friends and they're not for food. You know, whereas if you teach your children from young how animals, why animals were created, why they are food, how they are slaughtered for food, and like my wife has even shown my kids, hey, this is how they kill chickens for food, or this is how they kill cows for food. And you know, yeah, maybe at first they'll be freaked out by it, but if you're there to tell them, hey, this is just how it is, you know, this is what it is, the younger they are, the less freaked out they are by it, because they don't know what to think, right? They just know, okay, this is just how it is. This is just how it is that animals are our food and this is how it's created. And then if they grow up with that mentality, then they're not so shocked by it. Teach them from a young age that one reason God made the animals is not to be our friends, but to be food. And they won't get so freaked out. Just trying to make sure I got my points. Then, you know, they won't just believe that we're just one part of the animal kingdom. You know, right? That they just think that we're just part of the animal kingdom. And then they won't go out and vote for the Greens, who's campaigning to give animal rights, you know, same rights as human rights. So teach your children these things. What's another example? This whole idea of what the world would deem violence. And I already talked about Noah's Ark, so I won't go into this too much depth. But, you know, this idea that Noah's Ark is this, you know, this happy fairy tale type story. You know, even the rainbow in the sky, right? The Bible says here, and it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth that the bow shall be seen in the cloud and I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the water shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. So when you look at the rainbow with your children, and they're like, oh, wow, look at the rainbow, do you say, oh, wow, yeah, that's just the beauty of God's creation? Is that what you say? Or do you teach them what the Bible says? And you know what God made, you know, why did God put a rainbow in the sky? It's to remind us that he won't flood the world again, because there was a day when God was so angry with sin that he killed everybody except Noah on the ark. So every time we look at the rainbow, we need to be reminded of God's judgment, God's wrath on a sinful world. And that ought to make us desire the Savior, because that's what we deserve as sinners. So I'll skip over Noah for the sake of time. This is one I wanted to cover. So I talked about David and Goliath. Let's read here from 1 Samuel 17. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in his forehead. So we all know the story of David and Goliath, right? You know, the champion of the Philistines come out and he's like, oh, you know, bring me a man that we may fight. And David goes down to the brook and says, hey, you know, I slew the bear and the lion, and he gets five smooth stones. But whenever you see the fight of David and Goliath depicted in children's cartoons, what is it, right? He throws this stone and sometimes it just like knocks Goliath on the forehead and it just like knocks him out, right? But is that what we read in the Bible? Look at this. He smote the Philistine in his forehead that the stone sunk into his forehead. So this is like a bullet going through, you know, Goliath's head. That would not have been a pleasant sight, right? This is a headshot. And he fell upon his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone and smote the Philistine and slew him, but there was no sword in the hand of David. Now, when you learn about David and Goliath in Sunday school, that's where the story ends, right? David was triumphant. He slew the stone. He killed Goliath. They were victorious. But this is not where the story ends. This is not where the story ends in 1 Samuel 17. Therefore, David ran and stood upon the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of the sheath thereof and slew him and cut off his head therewith. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. So what happened after David threw the stone? He went and stood upon Goliath. He took his sword. He killed him, made sure he was dead, and then he cut his head off. Right? And the men of Israel and of Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines until thou come to the valley and to the gates of Ekron. And the wounded of the Philistines fell down by the way to Shaarim, even unto Gath and unto Ekron. And the children of Israel returned from chasing after the Philistines, and they spoiled their tents. Look at this. And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem. So he didn't just cut off the head and leave it there. He cut off the head and took it with him. But he put his armor in his tent. And when Saul saw David go forth against the Philistine, he said unto Abner, the captain of the host, Abner, whose son is this youth? And Abner said, as thy soul liveth, O king, I cannot tell. And the king said, inquire thou whose son the stripling is. And as David returned from the slaughter of the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said unto him, whose son art thou, thou young man? And David answered, I am the son of thy servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite. So we see here, this is not what children are told when they're shown what David did to Goliath. It wasn't just that he threw the stone and knocked him out. He threw the stone, it sunk into his forehead. He then killed him with his own sword, cut his head off, and then took the head and presented it to King Saul. Now, we have this idea that this would not be appropriate for children, but then God has this in the Bible. Why? Because he's trying to show an example of what God thinks about his enemies, right? Because Jesus is a man of war as well in Revelation, and one day he will do things worse, you know? And if we raise our children with this idea and it's just like, oh, well, I can't believe they do these things and it's so violent, blah, blah, blah. No, God is going to do worse when his enemies come up against him when Jesus returns. You know, there's going to be a battle at Armageddon too. What's another example? In 1 Kings 18, it says here, then the fire of the Lord fell. I didn't have all the scriptures here, but this is Elijah when he goes up against the prophets of Baal, right? And there's that great clash between them, where he says, we'll take a bullock each, right, and we'll divide it in pieces. And he says, you call upon your God and see if he answers, and I'll call upon my God, and whoever answers by fire, he will be the true God. And, you know, they're cutting themselves and doing all these things, and there's no answer day and night. And then what does Elijah do? Elijah prepares his bullock, and he puts it on the altar. But not only that, he pours water all over the altar to show that, hey, we're not just accidentally starting a fire here. And then he prays to God, and God consumes that burnt offering and licks up the fire. And that's usually where the story ends in Sunday school, right? There's this great triumph, right? That Elijah showed up these prophets of Baal. But that's not where the story ends. In 1 Kings 18, then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, he is the God. The Lord, he is the God. Now, does it end there? No. Verse 40. And Elijah said unto them, take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape. And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. So it's not just like it's fine to be a false prophet. You know, once it's proven, hey, these guys are false prophets, he says, hey, take the 40 prophets of Baal, take them down to the brook Kishon and kill them all. You know, because that's what God thinks about false prophets, you know, and that's what he's going to do, you know. So people might say, you know what, I can't believe, like, the Bible has these stories. I can't believe, you know, why would he want us teaching these to our children? Because we want to show the other side of God. Yes, God is a God of love and mercy, but he's also a God of wrath and judgment as well. And if you stay on the side of God's enemies, you know, you don't get saved and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, God is going to do much worse to that person than what we read in the Bible. You know, we read about him killing the prophets. We read about, you know, David and Goliath, you know, him getting killed by the stone, getting his head cut off. And you think that that's bad? Hey, that's nothing compared to hell. Right? And who created hell? God created hell. So if we paint this picture of God that he's all love and fuzzy and roses, why do you think people are so shocked when they realize, okay, God is the God of hell? He created hell because he's a God of wrath. He's a holy God as well. And this is what happens if you go on the side against God, a false prophet. You're an enemy of God. You don't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and get saved. What awaits you is judgment. And these are like examples to us to see, like, hey, this is how God deals with his enemies. This is how God deals with false prophets. It's just a picture of what's coming if people don't get saved and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, when I think of this, I think of this passage in Job where it talks about Leviathan. I don't know if you guys know Leviathan. You probably might have heard the name Leviathan. Some people believe Leviathan is the Tyrannosaurus Rex, right? I don't personally believe that Leviathan's the Tyrannosaurus Rex, because Leviathan is a sea creature. The Bible refers to him as a serpent. And even as we read this passage, you know, canst thou draw out Leviathan with a hook? It's talking about fishing, right? Like when you go fishing, you catch fish. You're not going to catch Leviathan with your fishing rod, that's what it's saying. So he lives in the water. You're probably like some sort of sea dragon, right? Because Leviathan is a fire-breathing dragon. A lot of people think that the Tyrannosaurus Rex is a hoax, right? Because this huge thing with this huge head, but it's got these tiny arms because it's trying to show that it's like, oh, you know, it's evolving, you know, from a chicken or whatever. It's evolving into a chicken or something like that. You know, it's got these small arms. So they think it's just like this hoax that, you know, why would an animal exist like that? You know, that's so impractical arms. You know, like every other creature that God has created is so practical. And, you know, people think, well, you know, do dragons exist and things like that? And then you look at the Chinese zodiac, right, the 12 creatures, and there's all these normal animals like goat, pig, cow, whatever. And then there's dragon. You kind of think, well, if dragon is a mythological creature, why is it on this zodiac of all these other normal animals? So, you know, dinosaurs were probably dragons, and Leviathan was probably a type of dragon, you know, that lived in the sea and probably one of the most ferocious of those dragons, because, you know, maybe at least in the sky, you can fight something on the ground, right? But in the sea, man has to be on a ship, and maybe that's why they're a lot more dangerous, pull you underwater and whatnot. So Leviathan is this, we're not going to read the passage where it talks about him breathing fire, but I do believe that Leviathan was this fire-breathing dragon that lived in the sea, very ferocious creature that God actually uses as an example of fear and bringing down people that are proud. Look, or his tongue with a cord which thou lettest down. Canst thou put a hook into his nose, or bore his jaw through with a horn? So it's like you can't even pierce his skin. Will he make many supplications unto thee? Will he speak soft words unto thee? So it's like, is Leviathan going to come to you like a dog and just beg for food? No, he's just going to eat you. Will he make a covenant with thee? Will thou take him for a servant forever? So it's like, are you even able to tame Leviathan? Wilt thou play with him as with a bird? Or wilt thou bind him for thy maidens? Shall the companions make a banquet of him? Shall they part him among the merchants? So are you going to sell him for food? Are you going to catch him and be able to eat him? Canst thou fill his skin with barbed irons or his head with fish spears? Saying, like, are you able to kill this beast? Lay thine hand upon him. Remember the battle. Do no more. So it's just saying, you know, you're not going to be able to kill him. You just got to remember that you fought him, but you're not going to do much more than that. Behold, the hope of him is in vain. Shall not one be cast down even at the sight of him? None is so fierce that dare stir him up. And look at this last bit. Who then is able to stand before me? Now that's a pretty chilling thought that, you know, if we actually saw Leviathan, you know, you think about those movies like Pirates of the Caribbean where they fight the Kraken, right? Comes up and kills the ship, and we're thinking like, hey, this thing is so ferocious, this thing breathes fire, literally, and he's using him as an example of something to fear, and he ends this by saying, what do you think it's going to be like when you face me? Ooh, like, God is somebody to be feared. Tomorrow can become the tragedy of too late. Now, we think about this a lot in terms of salvation, don't we? Where people, they leave salvation too late, they leave believing on the Lord Jesus Christ too late, and they say tomorrow can become the tragedy of too late, meaning if we leave it till later, there'll come a day when it's too late. And I feel like it's the same with our children, and this is why in the Bible reading, I did show you those picture books, but this is why I read through Moses. Because think about the story of Moses that we read. Remember when the child grew and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter and he became her son? And she called him his name Moses. And she said, because I drew him out of the water. Now, if you remember that story that we read about Moses, remember he was very young and luckily, you know, she put him in that ark of bulrushes and was able to take him back and nurse the child and then bring them back to Pharaoh's daughter. We are not told what age Moses is brought back to Pharaoh's daughter, but it's most likely after he was weaned, right? Because if the purpose of Pharaoh's daughter giving this child to this nurse, not knowing that it was the mother, it was to nurse the child and breastfeed them. You know, maybe he was there till he was two, who knows, maybe three. So you got to think, how long did Moses' mom have with him before she had to hand him over? What do you think? What do you think she would have tried to teach him before she handed him over to the Egyptians? And then you got to think of this, how long do you have with your children? Meaning, how much time do you have to influence them? What if your children are taken away from you? Hey, if the world keeps going the way it does, hey, maybe one day, what is it called? Docs. Yeah. Facts. So now it's facts, right? FACS, I think. Yeah, I think it used to be. Did it used to be called docs? Yeah, it used to be called docs. So now it's facts, right? What if they find out, hey, you're teaching your children all these Bible stories. You're spanking your children. You're abusing your children. And they come and take your children away. Wouldn't you have wished, man, I wish, you know, let's say you had the mindset, well, I'm not going to teach my children these until they're 6, 7 years old. And then let's say they get taken away at 6, 7 years old. You never got the chance to teach them. Have you ever thought about that? You know, you may not have the chance to teach them if the world keeps going how it does. But look at what happens with Moses. You know, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Why? Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. And again, these other ones. You know, to the point where Moses leads the people out of Egypt, right? He's used of God to perform one of the greatest miracles we read in the Bible, to part the Red Sea, that they walked across on dry land. So I think we underestimate the capacity of a child to learn and the influence that we can have on them at a very young age. You know, the Bible says, train up a child in the way they should go. When they are old, they will not depart from it. So that means you don't train them when they're old. You want them when they're old to not depart from what you have trained them. And I think about this when I think about teaching our children young and possibly not having the opportunity to teach them one day. Chasten thy son while there is hope, and let not thy soul spare for his crying. So this is talking about spanking them young, because one day, even if they're not taken away from you, one day it might get to the point where they don't want to listen anymore. They're not interested anymore. But when they were interested, you thought it wasn't appropriate for them. And now they're not interested, now you're trying to teach them, right? But the thing is, right, so if you don't teach your children, if you are not proactive about it, the haters of God, they don't care, right? The enemies of God, the haters of God are not scared to teach our children. You know, and they don't reproduce, right? The homosexual agenda. So they recruit. They go after the kids. That's why you get the Safe Schools program. And you have them, you know, running the media. They're trying to create. This is one reason why I do have a desire to create things for children, because I want to combat what the world is trying to get into our children. They create the video games. They create the cartoons. They create the picture books. We don't create any of this stuff to teach and to train our children. And a lot of the stuff that's out there, like I said, it's all watered down. It's not the real picture. It's not the Bible. So, you know, they're not scared to create those movies and all these things designed to brainwash your children. So take this on board, you know, for you guys that when you have children, I hope you take this sermon on board. Because, you know, we better make sure we get it into our children before it's too late, before the world gets it into our children, before Satan gets to our children. So let's teach them diligently unto thy children. All right, let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you that you give us guidance. Thank you that every word of God is pure. And Lord, we know that when we read our children the Bible, when we teach our children the Bible, we are giving them the unadulterated truth. We don't have to be worried. Are we teaching them the wrong thing? Are we giving them things that are beneficial, Lord, as we teach them the Bible and talk to them about the things of God? We know, Lord, that these things are beneficial and will be a blessing to them. Thank you, Lord, for giving us your word. We pray that we would study, that we, Lord, would hide it in our hearts so that we can teach our children diligently. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for your love. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.